So, hi everybody, and thank you for joining us to this webinar of Kids Eye Skills. Or we can still. Okay, so hi everybody again. Thank you for joining us on this Kids Life Skills webinar. I'm Ronen, I'm the founder of Kids Life Skills. Kids Life Skills is a nonprofit organization teaching computer coding and logical thinking to kids ages 4 to 13. Our mission is to empower kids with essential life skills, such as logical thinking, problem solving, self-learning, teamwork and collaborating, creativity and independent thinking. We don't really believe that we can teach creativity, but we can believe that we can either discourage or encourage it. Obviously, we try to encourage it as much as possible in our activities. So one of our main goals is to provide the kids with a positive technology experience, a technological experience. The reason is we don't want them to fear technology from a young age, so we let them try out and experiment a lot. And we also believe in very hands-on experience. So we have very small groups of 10 kids maximum per group with two team members for each one of the groups. This is actually before COVID-19. The reason is because it's very important for us that the kids would be able to feel and touch and play around, and each one would have their own turn, and they would have a lot of focus in each one of the sessions. So we also have parents and kids workshops. The idea is to allow the kids to be exposed to what the kids are doing in the workshops, and also so the parents would be able to help their kids later on at home if they work on a project. And also the most important thing for us is for the kids to be able to sort of teach the parents and show the parents what they've learned and what they've done, and to basically give them some quality time together working on projects. So how do we actually teach? What do we actually do in practice? So we start with off-screen activities. We start with the logic first. When in this case we show an activity of teaching the kids what is a sequence. In this specific activity, it's an activity that we created. We have what we call the human robot activity. So the instructor basically has these cards, which are action cards. The action cards that you can see in the pictures. And what these action cards do is each one of them represents a very basic basic action. For example, raise your right hand, jump, turn around, etc. So initially what we do is the instructor would lay out a sequence and then play out the sequence himself or herself. And then later on, we'll let the kids do it as well. So we let the kids build the sequence and also act out the sequence as the human robot. So we use this for several things. A few of them are, for example, redundancy. So for redundancy, what we would do is the instructor would create the sequence. And in that sequence, for example, we would put right hand on up, and then a few more actions. And then we'll say, without putting the right hand down, we'll say right hand up again. And then the kids acting out the human robot would say, wait, but my right hand is already up. And then we'll say, yes. And that's and that later on we connect that for them into, for example, programming languages. So for example, in Scratch, we have, it's built on X, Y coordinates. So for example, we have move by or go to. So if the kids are doing go to coordinates and the character has moved from where it is to a given coordinates, if they'll say the same command again and the same line again, they would say go to, the character wouldn't do anything. And then the kids say, oh, my program, it doesn't work. I've tried, it doesn't work. And then we say, okay, stop. And then we connect it to them to the right hand on, right hand up once and then twice. And they say, ah, now I get it. Another example for this is debugging. In this case, what we do is the instructor both sets up the sequence and plays it out. In that sequence, what we would do is we would put, for example, right leg up, and then a few more actions without putting the leg down. And then we'll say left leg up. And then what the instructor would do is the instructor would fall. Then we stop the exercise and we ask the kids, oh, what happened? Why did the robot fall down? Very quickly, the kids realize this, obviously. And also, they go very quick to find the solutions. If we see that they're able to find solutions very easily, we adjust the level of difficulty by saying, okay, now, for example, try to find a solution without removing any cards or without adding any other different cards. So then we can make it more challenging for them. After we do that, we move on to solving logical challenges and sequences using other methodologies. In this one, for example, the kids are playing out the robot themselves, but they have to solve a more complex challenge. So in the picture that we see below, it's very easy. The kids just have to put the arrows one after the other until they get from the green starting point to the red end point. And in the example that we see above, we've already added some obstacles and tasks. Obviously, we do this gradually. And this is a very interesting activity and very good one because it allows us to adjust the level of difficulty to the specific child in the group. We don't want to make it too difficult where they would be discouraged, and we don't want to make it too easy for the kids so they would be bored. So we have to find that sweet spot for each one of the kids. And well, as we have small groups, we know the kids very well. It's very easy for us to find that sweet spot for every one of the kids with the different activities. And then we keep it challenging for them. After that, we're moving on to programming of robotics. We're still in off-screen activities at that point. So there are still no computers and no tablets. And what the kids do here is basically they program a robot either using specific blocks that they put on a panel or a controller for a different robot. And with that, we teach them more complex concepts. And also we go up with the level of the different challenges that they would solve. Once we get to a very difficult level of challenge, then as you can see on the picture on the bottom right, we have the small cards that you see on the floor. Those are basically teaching them how to do planning for coding. So just like in real life, we don't go ahead and start by writing the code. We first think about the solution, we brainstorm, and then we do a design. And only then the more advanced stage is to actually code. So the same thing we apply here, where the problem becomes more complicated and they're having a hard time coding it directly into the device. Then we're saying, oh, what if we have these little cards and we can put them in sequence one after the other, and then it becomes much, much easier for them because they actually do all of the planning before. So once the kids are comfortable with the logic, and once we feel comfortable, we move on to coding onto the computer. The first programming language that we use is Scratch. It's a block-based visual programming language. Very easy, very intuitive for the kids. To understand, they don't have to write the syntax themselves. They just drag and drop blocks of logic, and then they can create some very, very interesting projects, games, all kinds of different interesting projects. This one we use for ages 7 to 10. And for the younger kids, we use a tool that's called Scratch Junior. Scratch JR stands for Scratch Junior, which is very similar, slightly more limited in capabilities. But the nice thing about it is that it allows us to teach kids starting from the age of 4 the same concept. So they don't have to know how to read and write. As you can see, all of the blocks are basically pictures or paintings. So the kids can do this without even knowing how to read and write. As it's very important for us that the kids wouldn't have the perception that the code that they write just have to stay on the screen, that it could affect and be affected by external devices, input and output, it's very important for us to connect the code that we write to something in the physical world. So in this case, what we've done here is we call it a Play-Doh piano. It's a project on Scratch, which is connected to a Makey Makey device. A Makey Makey device is a device that simulates a part of a keyboard, and basically by closing an electric circuit allows the simulation to pretend as if we press one of the keys on the keyboard. So here in this project, after the kids are building all of it, they're touching one Play-Doh and then they can play on the other ones, and it plays like the piano that they see on the screen. So this is very, very interesting and very nice for the kids. Then once we feel comfortable with a few projects that we've done, we're moving them to a different programming language. We also use Thinker. In this case, I chose to show Blockly. The reason that we move them from one programming language to another, or mainly from Scratch to another programming language, is because it's very important for us that the kids wouldn't have the perception of, oh, I know Scratch. So I know Scratch equals coding and coding equals Scratch. So once we take them to another program, they very quickly see that all of the logical blocks that they know from scratch exist here as well. They say, oh, an if statement, I know that, repeat, I know that. Even if there are a few more advanced features, they pick it up very quickly, and then they realize that, oh, even if it looks and feels a bit different, the core basic principles behind it are the same. Another reason that we like using Blockly is because it allows the kids and us to see the code, for example, in JavaScript or Python. So the kids can code in blocks, and then they can choose which language they want it to be shown in. And then in that language, they will see the code in actual code. And after that, it's time again to throw them to yet another different programming language. In this case, we chose as an example, App Inventor. App Inventor again is in the category of drag and drop blocks, but this one already is more advanced, allows usages of databases, lets the kids already develop applications that could be deployed on smartphones and tablets, and then they can later on go to their parents or friends, say, hey, download my game, my application, whatever they build. Very empowering for the kids. In addition to that, throughout all of the programs, we use a lot of robotics. For example, this project that we do with MBot is a project that the kids basically get a kit of MBot. MBot is a robotic kit that you can build in all kinds of different configurations. So what we do is we have a discussion with the kids, and then we choose a challenge. Then according to that, the kids actually physically build the robot, and then they're programming the robot for that specific challenge. So it's a very nice project. In this one, we use something that's called a SphereBot. So the SphereBot, the one that you see on the bottom right of the screen, is basically a programmable robot or ball. And in this specific activity, this is after the kids have already learned how to program the SphereBot and how to control it and how to use the sensor. So for example, when it hits a wall, you get a sensor reading. So in this case, what we've done is we've built a maze, and we showed the maze to the kids, and we told them, okay, now you have to write a code to solve the maze. So the ball would go from the beginning point all the way to the end point. The kids said, no problem, and they solved it quite quickly. Later on, what we've done in this exercise is we took the maze away and we told them, okay, now you need to write a code for a different maze. But this time you're not going to see the maze. So you have to write a code for a maze. This was already a bit more challenging for the kids. At this point, usually they say, oh, but how can we do this? We don't see the maze. How do we know? With a few guiding questions, they figure it out on their own, and usually quite quickly. And then they write a generic code to solve any maze available. Then we try it out with a few mazes, and we see that it works, and the kids are very happy with the results. So kids' life skills progress. Basically, we've started in the beginning of 2019, where we had just three groups. We planned to have just two groups, but we had three groups. It was just me as an instructor. Later on, we grew and we had more and more groups. COVID slowed us down a bit, but now in the upcoming trimester, we're already going to have, I think, either 16 or 18 groups. I'm not sure about the final number, but we're growing very fast and very rapidly. This is actually a team photo from last year. This year, our team has doubled, and we have 20 team members. Two of them are volunteers that are doing an amazing job. The rest are instructors, coaches, and an admin. So we're happy to say that we're being supported by FNR, Digital Luxembourg, and PwC. FNR and Digital Luxembourg's support is a financial support, and it allows us to support low-income families. In one of the activities that we've done, and this was way back in the beginning before we had the support, I had in my group this father that came with his two girls, and we were already doing everything at cost level, so there wasn't much room for margin. And the girls loved it, and they were super excited. They ran out of the classroom at the end of the lesson to their father saying, oh, we want to register. And then the father came and spoke to me, and he asked for a discount. Now, even though our activities are done at cost level, the cost level is quite expensive because we have small groups and a lot of equipment and expenses. So not that expensive. It's 100 euros for four sessions, for example. But still, for some people, it could be a major expense. So he asked me, the father came to me and asked me, can I get a discount? And I apologized, and I said, no, I'm sorry, we don't have any flexibility on that. It's already at cost level. Now we do. And now, thanks to FNR and Digital Luxembourg's support, we can offer up to 75% of subsidies. So we're very happy about that. And we're very happy to see that more kids are joining using those subsidies. It's according, obviously, to income level. But this is already helping us to accomplish one of our main goals, which is to be as inclusive as possible. So we've already, in addition to our regular sessions, we've also started a pilot with the Ministry of Education through IFEN, where we teach teachers of schools in Luxembourg, of public schools in Luxembourg, how to deliver our curriculum and the methodologies and the concepts in the classroom. That way we can reach many more kids. We've started the pilot in January 2020, and just now recently we've signed a contract with them, moving this project forward. Thank you.